Chapter 9. Solos and Small Combos. The loudest argument people use to fight brainstorming is that it is a group activity which needs 12 people. Opponents of the technique point out that man, even organization man, is essentially a lonely animal. They are absolutely right. No matter how many conferences a sales manager has to attend, he spends much more time by himself. The same thing is true of the medical administrator, the teacher, the engineer. The average executive, committee-bound as he may feel, rarely spends more than 10% of his time in meetings. And, since few committees accomplish much except to confirm what has already been done, it is obvious that most ideas come to people when they are alone. Most problems are solved by a lonely individual staring at the drawing board or out a window. In fact, just about every final decision is reached by one man alone. Even if it is kicked around in 100 conferences and confirmed by a dozen committees. Therefore, this is a most pertinent question about brainstorming. Can I use it during the 90% of the time I work alone? The answer, an unqualified yes. I have developed, tested, and practiced solo brainstorming that can just as effectively increase the creativity of individuals as a group. Brainstorming can stimulate originality in groups. The solo brainstormer adapts the same basic rule. No negative thoughts, as the brainstorm panel. Since he obviously does not have to get 12 busy people together, he has almost complete mobility. All he has to have is a pencil and what I call an idea trap. Some sort of paper which will preserve the fleeting but practical ideas produced by solo brainstorming. The idea trap can be a pocket notebook, a legal-sized sheet of paper, a clipboard, a desk pad, the back of an envelope, a 3x5-inch card, anything that can be tucked away and saved until there is time to apply judgment to the ideas. As in the group brainstorm, the first step is to pick a good question, a spade question that will produce specific answers. Once that is done, I like to have my secretary hold off all calls and callers for a brief period of time, say 5, 10 or 15 minutes, while I brainstorm. If that isn't easy, I slip off to an empty conference room. I take a legal pad of paper, a pen, and, as fast as I can, write down any ideas which come into my head on the problem under attack. Surprisingly enough, most of us have negative thinking so well built into our system that it is easy to think killer phrases. Then we have to ring a bell mentally on ourselves. We do seem just as anxious to hide silly ideas, even if no one is ever going to see our list. Solo brainstorming takes some discipline, just as group brainstorming. We have to learn to freewheel, but if we do, it is amazing what the subconscious can produce. Many times you will find that you have been carrying in your head solutions to problems that logic wouldn't let you express, even to yourself. While you were looking at the problem in the proper professional way, your subconscious was having its own offbeat and often brilliant ideas. Once you have them down on paper, your professional background can make the difference by turning them into profits. Solo brainstorming can be carried on anywhere. Many commuters find that they can brainstorm a problem they will face during the day on their way back to work. Some men, who travel a great deal, brainstorm in the air or in the club car. Some brainstorm how best to use the time they'll waste travelling and come up with some problem. You guessed it, to brainstorm. Many executives brainstorm before getting out of bed in the morning. especially if they've got to think about the problem before going to sleep and let their subconscious puzzle over it while they snored. Others like to brainstorm just before they turn off the light at night, when their subconscious is crowded with the impressions from a busy day. Obviously, a solo brainstorm lacks the stimulation of many minds. There are ways to beat this, however, which can be easily applied to any job. If the problem to be solved involves something small and tangible, a package for frozen fish sticks, a new casting for an engine, the sole of a shoe, it's helpful to handle the object, looking at it from every different angle, holding it upside down, sideways, turning it around in your hands. You might take different materials and apply your other senses to them. Depending on the goods, you might cut it, tear it, try to blend it, run your hands over it, even bite or smell it. The thing to do is to look at an old problem in a new way. Then, as you get a new idea, no matter how screwy, write it down. You can stimulate your own brainstorms in 100 ways. A toy manufacturer brainstorms by parking his car beside a playground and watching a children at play. A production boss walks along an assembly line, notebook in hand, noting down every idea that occurs to him. Thumbing through magazines, the indices of technical journals. A catalogue of parts can be stimulating if it bears a relationship to your problem. For example, a chemist might ignite ideas by glancing through a list of chemicals offered by a supply house. While he did it, his subconscious might hook up combinations of chemicals he would never have thought of logically. A writer I know gets ideas by wandering through a library, haphazardly, walking from section to section, looking at titles, idly flipping open books, hitting on ideas almost by chance. A sales manager can brainstorm by strolling through a busy supermarket or department store. An architect by driving slowly past many homes. A city planner by flying over his home in a helicopter. One way to brainstorm drugstore displays, for example, is to drop into a dozen drugstores, chat with the owners about what displays they use and why, and then sit in the car and note down any ideas you get, either from talking with the druggist, from seeing competitors' display, or just by seeing a drugstore in a new light. To be an effective solo brainstormer, you might keep books or pamphlets handy, which stimulate you. We all have certain books or people who stimulate us. We might call up a friend who is stimulating to us, have him out for a drink or lunch, talk with him about the problem or other things. You won't solve the problem then, but time after time, you'll have good ideas after leaving him. Books and pamphlets, which stimulate new thoughts, run the gamut of everything published. They might be technical books in your field. It might be the Bible or Thoreau's Walden or poetry. It might be Iron Age, Ogden Nash, or even the lecture notes you took in Professor Doriot's class 20 years before. Sometimes we need to see our problems simply, and this can be done by going back to basic textbooks, or even books written for children about our subject. You may be a graduate engineer with 15 years experience building bridges, but just because of that fact, you may have lost the simple essentials in your professional awareness of all the details of your profession. A lunch hour in an art museum, especially one devoted to modern works, can make you see colour and shape in new and wonderful ways. The same way a phonograph record can make you hear differently. One of the most basic rules of creative thinking is observation. We all have to see to give impressions to our subconscious. Whenever possible, we should brainstorm by seeing our problem in a new and simple way. Not as a professional sees it, but as a visitor might if he came from Mars. There are practically no limits to the subjects which can be brainstormed, and this is especially true of the solo brainstorm. You can brainstorm important decisions in your career. What to give your wife for her birthday? What to cook your husband for anniversary dinner? How to sell more of your product? What you want in the new home you're building? How to sell your own home? Where to find money to start your own company? How to ask the boss for a raise? How to answer a difficult letter? How to raise money for the new church? Where to go on your vacation? How to file articles from medical journals? What college to attend? How to propose to your girlfriend? Where to find a new job? After you have brainstormed your problem, have a cold water session. Wait a day or so, then quickly run down the list, crossing off ideas that are no good and underlying the ones that to put to work. Sometimes it's a good idea to file these lists so that you can refer to them. 1. To jog yourself into acting on them. 2. To use when you hit the same or similar problems later. In every case, it is a good idea to check up on yourself to force yourself to act. You might note the ideas you intend to act upon on paper and tape it to the outside of your desk drawer so you see it every day, or in your sock drawer so you see it every morning. The list might be pasted to the mirror you use when shaving, on the other side of the sunshade in the car, inside your briefcase, or stuck in the back of a book you are reading. Some men have their wives or secretaries send them the list through the mail in a week or a month. No matter how you do it, there should be some way to put pressure on yourself to do something about the ideas you have from a brainstorm. You won't be an idea man until you've done something. But if you practice solo brainstorming, you will have ideas. New ideas on hundreds of problems you've never been able to lick before. And they will be ideas which will make a difference in your life. Just as brainstorming can be used by one person, as well as the classic dozen, so it works miracles for 2 or 3 people in the office. There's rarely any need for formal invitation. When 2 or 3 people are together working on a problem, one may suggest, "Let's brainstorm it." That's all that's needed. One member picks up a pencil and paper. The brainstorm begins. Sometimes, an assistant will regularly brainstorm with his boss on the problems ahead during the day. Other executives make it a habit to have a quick telephone brainstorm when they hit a snag on the problem. A conference hookup can easily be arranged with the telephone company. And this is especially valuable when the sales manager in the New York office needs to brainstorm a problem with the production boss in the Ohio plant and the design engineer of a supplier hundreds of miles away from each of them. The time, place, or the number of people is not vital. The important thing is that the subconscious is made to attack the problem with minimum difficulty and maximum effectiveness. It can produce amazing results with little damage to the day's schedule. A team of 3 advertising men, for example, can brainstorm an idea. How can we use the morning's news on plastics to sell our campaign? This brainstorm can be held in the taxi on the way to the presentation, and the cab driver might come up with an idea too. Some executives will brainstorm their secretaries to get a woman's idea on a problem. Others contact a special customer or 2, a foreman on the line with years of experience, a young assistant who is new to the business but loaded with ideas. One company which has done astonishing things with the small Brainstorm group is the Reynolds Metals Company, under the direction of Cloyd Steinmetz, the Live Wire Director of Sales Training. Creative thinking has been made an integral part of their operation. For hard-headed, practical results, listen to this. Summer was an aluminium slump period. Reynolds applied creative thinking to the problem. Brainstorming played a leading role, and they came up with hundreds of ideas, their barbecue kit, foil cookbooks, and so forth. In 3 years, summer became the peak period, and they started to brainstorm ways to boost winter sales. Recently, a division manager, an experienced salesman, and the new one called on a supermarket owner and tried to sell him Reynolds' 75-foot economy roll of foil. They had all their statistics down pat, their arguments worked out. They made a classic presentation. He wasn't sold. He refused to carry the item. Instead of going out and griping, they had a three-man on-the-spot brainstorm session, and the youngest member came up with an idea. That night they called on the owner and presented him with a bottle of his favourite wrapped in economy roll in such a way that he had to unroll all the aluminium to get to the whiskey. He unrolled foot after foot, and when he had 67.5 feet, this was scrawled in huge letters on the foil. This last 12.5 feet, the housewife gets free when she buys economy roll in your store. When he got to the bottle, he said, "Sit down, boys, and let's open the bottle." He bought the economy roll. Another salesman couldn't sell the aluminium package of cake mix Reynolds was pushing in a pineapple upside down cake promotion. He went home and brainstormed the problem and came up with a screwy idea. He baked an upside down cake himself and then, dressed in his wife's apron, drove the cake, piping hot, down to the store and served it to the sales manager and some customers. He got the sale, and the sales manager wrote the head of his company. The result? The item was sold to the whole nationwide chain. In Reynolds' Los Angeles packaging division office, for example, they couldn't have a classic dozen brainstorm. They only have 5 men. Instead, they have a regular weekly 5-man brainstorm. Each week, in rotation, one of the men picks his toughest sales prospect, and all 5 brainstorm how to sell him. This has boosted sales in that area enormously. Brainstorming is a part of every Reynolds sales meeting, and the men who come off in the road have contributed literally hundreds of usable sale-producing ideas to every Reynolds division. One of the best things about a small brainstorm is that it has none of the inhibiting factors of a big meeting. It can be casual and bring together people of all ages and levels, white collar and blue collar, without any difficulty. In the shop, a foreman, design engineer, and a machinist can brainstorm a new way to produce a product as they stand around the machine that will have to do the job. When a production line grinds to a halt, the breakdown can be brainstormed on the spot. At Hot Point in Chicago, a plant superintendent and 2 general foremen were turned down after they requested a $200,000 conveyor system. The 3 didn't cry in their beer. They sat down and brainstormed the problem. The result was an equally efficient system. Price? Only $4,000. Andrew R. Barr, supervisor of the Esso Standard Oil Company's New York division, gets a handful of mechanics together during a coffee break when he runs into problems. They stand around the problem in question. Recently, one was on how to reach an unloading valve in a difficult spot with a wrench. The problem was solved before the coffee was finished, by an idea of using a different wrench in an unconventional way. That's typical of what can be done. Try it yourself. Brainstorm with your boss, your secretary, associates, assistant. Make it a regular part of your workday, and you'll be amazed how easily it will solve problems and produce valuable ideas.